Well, good morning, Canyon Springs. Would you stand with me, please, and welcome? And we want to welcome our Facebook friends and brothers and sisters in Christ for worshiping with us this morning. Page, if you want to turn in the hymnal, 444, I'd love to tell the story. The reason we love to tell the story is because you want to hear it over and over. I love to tell the story of the unseen things above, of Jesus and His glory, of Jesus and His love. I love to tell the story because I know 'tis true. It satisfies my longing as nothing else can do. I love to tell We talked about Jesus' love. It's the love of God. The love of God is greater far than tongue or pen can ever tell. It goes beyond the highest star and reaches to the lowest hell. And strong. take a minute and greet your neighbor, tell them how you missed them.
Singing the love of God. Amen. What a blessing to be in church and to be able to talk about Jesus and his love for us. A lot of things going on in the life of ministry here. And let me just say this to you. If you're visiting with us, boy, we are so glad that you're here. We'd love to have a record of your visit. There's a connection card there. And I even mentioned this, that on the back of the connection card, there's a prayer card. And if you'd like a prayer request or something that's mentioned, we can get it into our prayer guide that we have. We love to pray about that. We love to pray for one another and lift up these requests to the Lord. Now, just thinking about a couple things that are going on and some things that are happening in just a little bit. Starting in June 7th, I think it's a Wednesday night at 6 o'clock, we're going to start our summer Bible fellowship. What is that? Well, it's just a good time to get together on a Wednesday night at 6 o'clock. We're going to have a meal provided for you, and you come, and we're going to eat together as a church family, and then we're going to have a Bible study, and it only lasts between about 6 to 7 o'clock. Depends upon how much you talk, right? But I'll make sure that we do a good job keeping it slim down there. But this is a great opportunity to fellowship in the middle of the week during the summer months. And so we're going to have an in-depth Bible study each and every week on the Wednesday night. And so you be a part of that. Also, fathers, we're going to have Father's Day, special Father's Day, special gifts for all the fathers. Be thinking about that. Make sure you plan on being here and being a part of that very special Father's Day service. And then we want to be thinking about some of those things. Some of you have already brought in some sodas and water. We've asked that you would donate those and bring those over to the fellowship hall. That helps us all summer long, providing waters and sodas for our summer Bible fellowship. And then, of course, we have information about the Sunday morning snacks. Many of you get to enjoy that after your Sunday school Bible lesson. Great lesson this morning out of Romans chapter 12 and chapter 13. Good, very practical things. I'd encourage you, make your way on over to the fellowship hall at 9:30 on Sunday mornings. A great Bible lesson. And then right here, we'll have our main service at 10:30. All right. So you're here. We appreciate you. We're looking forward to worshiping the Lord together and having a great, great day. Let's stand again. Let's sing a little bit more as we go further in the service here. The Old Rugged Cross.
Till my trophies at last I lay down.
Favorite songs. I appreciate that. If you have your Bibles, we're going to have a little scripture reading today. Acts chapter number 17 in your Bibles. We're going to read several verses together for our scripture reading this morning. Acts chapter number 17. The Bible says there in verse number 1, "Now when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where there was a synagogue of the Jews. And Paul, as his manner was, went in unto them, and 3 Sabbath days reasoned with them out of the Scriptures, opening and alleging that Christ must needs have suffered and risen again from the dead, and that this Jesus, whom I preach unto you, is Christ. And some of them believed and consorted with Paul and Silas, and of the devout Greeks a great multitude, and of the chief women not a few. But the Jews which believed not, moved with envy, took upon them certain lewd fellows of the baser sort, and gathered a company, and set all the people in an uproar, and assaulted the house of Jason, and sought to bring them out to the people. And when they found them not, they drew Jason and certain brethren unto the rulers of the city, crying, These that have turned the world upside down are come hither also, whom Jason hath received, and these all do contrary to the decrees of Caesar, saying, There is another king, one Jesus. And they troubled the people and the rulers of the cities when they heard these things, and when they had taken security of Jason and of the other, they let them go, and the brethren immediately sent away Paul and Silas by night unto Berea, who coming thither went into the synagogue of the Jews." May the Lord have his blessing on the word of God this morning. Lord Jesus, we ask you, Lord, to bless your word. We ask you, Lord, to bless this service. Lord, we're singing about your love. We're singing about the cross and that old rugged cross. And Lord, today as we open up your word, may we get a hold of this message for our lives today. And Lord, we do ask, Lord, that you'd bless our guests and our visitors and those that are with us. We think of our family, Lord. We think of those that are ill. We think of Janet today. Lord, thank you that she's out of the hospital. I pray that, Lord, that you restore her and help her and give her strength. Lord, we think of others that we love that are going through difficulties. Lord, as we think about this scripture, the believer's responsibility here in the world that we live, help us, Lord, to understand these things in such a way that would change our lives. Bless this scripture in your name. Amen. Thank you. All right, what a blessing. All right, we're going to go ahead and let our children be dismissed at this time for time in junior church. I know that that will be a blessing. Appreciate Miss Orrick and how she takes care of that ministry and does a good job with that. If your child would like to be involved in that, if you would like them not to come back, just let us know. We can maybe arrange that. Some of you parents, you know, they've asked me about that. I said, well, we like to return them, you know. But we'll see what we can do here. Hold your place there in Acts 17. We're going to be here for the most of the time today. And we're going to look at the Apostle Paul, one of his missionary journeys here. And see some things that we, and we're going to mention several things, and I think it'll be helpful to you. Here in Acts chapter 17, we're seeing Paul's missionary journey where he is passing through several areas from Philippi. So in chapter 16, he goes to Macedonia, he goes to Philippi, he meets Lydia there, and there is a church formed in Philippi. Paul and Silas were falsely imprisoned and beaten and basically run out of town at the end of chapter 16. But Paul and Silas continue going in life. You know, sometimes life is that way. There will be some ups and downs. And guess what? Let me tell you what you have to do. You have to continue. You have to just get up the next day and keep on going. Will there be struggles? Yes, there will be. But, you know, one of the things that we have to recognize that just like my girls got to sing that song about a secret place and how grace is going to be there and love and kindness is all going to be there. You know, it doesn't mean that in the absence of a difficult circumstance. No, that's exactly when the Lord shines through, is in the middle of some of these things. And so here Paul was in the middle of that on the run, and he just keeps on going. And I want you to notice, look at verse 2 with me at chapter 17. It says, and Paul, as his manner was, went in unto them, and 3 Sabbath days reasoned with them. And so this is a 3-week evangelistic Bible teaching time where he goes into Thessalonica. They are a Roman city. Greeks are there. Jews are there. There's obviously a synagogue. And he goes to them and he begins to preach to them and teach to them and share with them the glorious gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, he's doing this, and I want you to notice his pattern. It says, as his manner was. So what you'll do is if you read the book of Acts and you read some of his travels, he'll go to a city and he'll find the synagogue. This is where Jewish people are. We're trying to worship God. And he'll go to them, and he was a Pharisee of the Pharisees, and so he'll go to them, and he'll begin to open and allege and share the scriptures with them about Jesus. And then the people outside of that, God-fearing people, would hear about that, and Paul would give the gospel to them also. So this was his pattern. And so you notice his pattern when he goes to this new city in Thessalonica. It says that he was there for 3 weeks and he was using the scripture, out of the scripture. Now his pattern is found right there in verse number 2. It says, 3 Sabbath days reasoned with them out of the scriptures. And so he reasoned with them. He had an open dialogue. That's what that means. It was like, hey, what do you think about this scripture? I kind of think maybe he went to Isaiah chapter 53 and maybe Isaiah chapter 55 and says, hey, that man of sorrows, who do you think that is? Let me tell you about Jesus. He was born and he was stricken and he was whipped and by his stripes we are healed. And so I kind of think that he reasoned with them out of the scriptures. And so this is a Paul's pattern. And then he would go to a place and he would open the scriptures. not just opening of a book, but he would bring it to light, if you will. He would explain what the scripture meant. And this is a great idea for those of us that want to see people get saved. Sometimes it's more than just giving them the facts. Sometimes it's helping them understand what the scripture is, explaining it to them. And then also look at what Paul did here in verse number 2. His pattern was that opening, and notice it says, and alleging that Christ must needs have suffered and risen again. And this, and that this Jesus whom I preach unto you is Christ. So not only was he reasoning, having this open dialogue with them, not only was he opening the word of God or explaining it to them, what it meant, but he was also persuading them with the evidence. Here's the word of God. Here's what the Bible says. Here's what Jesus did. Here is Jesus who he is. And so he's persuading. There's a lot of people that like to talk about Jesus, but you know what? Let me encourage you. There comes a time when you got to persuade someone towards the cross. Amen. You have to persuade them to be saved. You have to let them know that they need a Savior, and this Jesus, the God of the Bible, Jesus of the Bible, is the only one that can save you. So we need to be persuading them. And then notice the center of his discussion. You notice the main point, if you will, and we see that right there in verse number 3, opening alleging that Christ must have suffered and risen from the dead, and that this Jesus. So who's the center part of this discussion? This is Jesus. We can get sidetracked. How many of you can? Amen? We get sidetracked very easily. And boy, that's the number one thing. And you know what? If you're concerned about somebody and you want to witness to them and you want to see them, you know, come to Christ, hey, let me just tell you, be ready for rabbit trails. Be ready for sidetrack. They're going to say, well, does that mean that if I get saved, I can't do this? That's a sidetrack. We got to sometimes keep it central theme, like what's the main thing? And this is what Paul was doing. So what a great pattern Paul gives us for going to a place and talking to someone, reasoning with them, explaining the scriptures, persuading them about Jesus. And notice the product of that preaching. You know, sometimes my wife makes a good soup. And so she puts all the ingredients in a pot and boils it. Now, I'm simplifying it, okay, ladies, okay? But boiling it, amen? Puts all the little spices in there. And at the end, that's a beautiful bowl of soup. I really enjoy that. A lot of different ingredients in there. And the soup is the end result of all the different ingredients. So what's the end result of Paul's going to a place, finding people that are interested in God, and discussing with them about the Old Testament, about the scriptures, discussing them about Jesus, how he died, and he was buried, rose again the third day, and he's persuading them. What is the product? What is the evidence? What is the end of all of that preaching? Notice here, verse 4, and some of them believed and consorted with Paul and Silas and of the devout Greeks, a great multitude, and a chief women, not a few. So guess what happened? Paul goes there for 3 weeks, and it says some of them believed. That's good. Not just a few numbers, but quite a bit. The Bible says quite a few people, a multitude here. And he says of the chief women, I think it was at the end of verse 4, not a few. That means, you know what? You couldn't really hold, you know, sometimes we have to take our hands and then we take our shoes off to be able to count, right? I mean, you didn't have to do that. There was quite a few people there. There was a lot of people there. And so, boy, the gospel was going forward. Paul persuaded them and people got saved. But notice the product was also that some believed, and according to verse 5, some didn't believe. Doesn't that just discourage us? Oh, sure it does, but it's a reality. Not everyone that you talk to about the Lord Jesus Christ is going to receive that wholeheartedly. You know what I'm saying, right? Now, sometimes what we do is we share our faith with somebody, and you know, they don't necessarily receive it very well. They believe not, if you will. And what we do is we say, "Oh, I've been rejected. I'm rejected. Oh, poor me. Oh, no. So guess what? I'm just going to stop going to these cities. I'm going to stop opening and alleging. I'm going to stop reasoning. I'm going to stop persuading." All because some believed, yeah, that's great. But some didn't. Now, let me just tell you, the reality is some will believe and some will not. Now, we notice here in verse number 5, let's talk about those Jews which believe not. They were unbelieving. And you'll see that throughout the book of Acts and throughout Paul's writings, it seemed like Paul, who was a Pharisee of Pharisees, quite constantly had run-ins and difficulties with the Jewish religious establishment, right? Everywhere he'd go into the synagogue, and guess what? You know what? He'd get run out of town. This is probably the third or maybe the fourth place where he gets run out of town for fear of his life. But notice what is left behind. In fact, a glorious church, whereas later Paul would write two more books to this little church here. The book of 1 Thessalonians and the second book of Thessalonians. So Paul writes back to this. So this is the beginning of this Thessalonian church here. But sometimes you will find yourself in trouble. You'll find yourself in less than optimal circumstances. The gospel will take you to places where, as you are reasoning and opening and alleging and trying to persuade and you're doing what God wants you to do, there's oftentimes some will believe, but some will not, and you might have a little trouble. Look at verse 5. "But the Jews which believe not, moved with envy, took unto them certain lewd fellows of the baser sort." You say, "Pastor, what does that mean, the baser sort?" Well, the root word of that word baser is base, right? Which is kind of the, anytime you build a building, you build, it's the base first, right? And really what it means is a low place. These people were lowlifes. You know, the kind of people that would steal your car stereo at 3 a.m. in the morning? The ones that are out hanging out? The kind of people that would just kind of, hey, get involved in a riot, that kind of person. So they're the base, the simple, the those kind of, that's what that means there, the baser sort. And notice they gathered a company, they got a crowd together. And the Bible says here, they set all the city on an uproar and assaulted the house of Jason. That means they caused a riot. So the Jews typically loved to get other people to do the dirty work. Isn't that interesting? And this is why what we say with our words can cause some serious problems. In our home, Tracy and I, we've been in a few arguments, one or two, right, honey? Something like that. And sometimes it's a miscommunication. Like one of the kids will say, "Mom said this." And so then I say, "You said this." And then we say, "Wait a minute, you didn't hear that correctly." And then Mom and I have to, "Hey, we're on the same page. Let's get rid of them." You know what I mean? That's, you know, that's, we say they're the enemy now. You know, let's get rid of them or whatever. But sometimes we find ourselves in those situations because we get information from somebody else. And so it's always a good habit. It's always a good habit before you go hot and heavy on some information that you, hey, make sure you go to the source. Don't believe it unless you know it. It's okay. Go ahead and think the best of people. I think that'd be a good thing. You have a lot better relationships. In fact, you'll have a lot more relationships when you just consistently say, "You know what? I'm going to give other people the benefit of the doubt because I sure do need it." Now, I want you to notice this phrase here in verse 6. So this riot is going out, and they're running for their life. In verse 6, and when they found them, they drew Jason and certain brethren unto the rulers of the city, crying. And so you can see this riot. They go to the city. They got Jason and another brethren there. And they say, these people, Paul and Silas were here. And these people here, what are they doing? And it says right there, it says, these have turned the world upside down or come hither also. And so they are so concerned. These are the concerned citizens. These people are following God, and we can't have that. These people are living holy lives. We can't have that. These people aren't buying the idols that we make. We can't have that. In fact, reputation of Paul going to these cities, in fact, in Philippi and other places that he was at, guess what? They wanted to kill him because he spoke out against their gods and said, they're not God at all. He spoke out against that idol worship and the making of idols. And so think about Christians becoming Christians, and they say, wait a minute, every day I don't have to go down and dip myself in the river. I don't have to go down and buy an idol from you that's not an idol at all. I don't have to do these things. And so guess what? Freedom was coming in the form of spiritual freedom to these people. And guess what? The crowd didn't want. And so they said, these men have turned the world upside down. Now, I want you to think with me here. Let's go over to chapter 5 of the book of Romans. Just real quick, a couple of verses here. Romans chapter number 5. Now, they were accused of turning the world upside down. I mean, they were causing problems. Now, I want to submit to you that what these unbelieving people, the ones that believe not, what they were striving to do was they were upset that their status quo, the way we've done it, our lives, we want it to remain the same. We don't want to change. But I submit to you that they said it was right side up. They turned the world upside down. But I submit to you, with Jesus, it's turning the world back to where it should be. Amen. Look what Romans chapter 5 and verse number 8 says. But God commendeth his love towards us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Now look at verse 12. Wherefore by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin. So death passed upon all men, for all have sinned. Now, hopefully I don't have to go over the story of Adam and Eve. You know that passage. You could eat of every tree of the Garden of Eden. There was spiritual freedom. You could walk with the Lord. You could talk with the Lord. But one day, there was sin. And sin came into the world, and the world was cursed. In fact, Romans chapter 8 says that the whole world groaneth. That means that this world has been sin sick. And so, guess, go over with me to 1 John chapter 2, please. Over to the right in your Bibles. If you make it to 1 and 2 Peter, just keep going. 1 John chapter 2. And so they were so upset that Paul was coming and reasoning out of the scriptures, that he was opening and alleging or bringing to light what the Bible says. They were so upset that he was persuading other people to come and to believe on Jesus because of what Jesus did. He died, he was buried, and rose again. And so they brought men, believers, if you will, in front of the city and said, these are the ones that we heard about. And they've turned the world upside down. Speaking of Paul's reputation in Philippi and these other places, whereas he was run out of town and the gospel was going forward. Now they're saying, these are the ones that are doing it. And they're here. and we want nothing to do with that. Let me show you what the world is doing. Look at verse 15 of chapter 2. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Notice this phrase in verse 16. For all that is in the world, okay? That's the current place we're living, okay? The world. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. Now, so this is what the world lives by. The lust of the eyes, or the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. That is the direction that the world goes by. And for them, that's normal. For them, that's the same. For them, that's the sweet life. For them, that's all. And guess what? They don't want anyone messing with what they've been doing. Here is Paul, comes into the city, preaches that Christ has come. And he died and he's buried and rose again. And he persuaded them with evidence who Jesus was. And now they are the ones that are turning the world upside down. I submit to you, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And guess what? It was without sin. And therefore, Satan brought sin into the world. And guess what? That is when the world turned upside down. And Jesus makes it right side up. So maybe we need to understand these truths. And so I guess we could say, hey, preacher, okay, I want to do that. I don't want to just keep on going with this world upside down. I want to be the right side up, if you will. And I want to turn this world upside down on their head, if you will. I want to make a difference. I want to be, you know, a difference maker. How do we do that? Well, I think, let me just be really brutally honest with you. It's not necessarily me. It's not necessarily a program. It's not necessarily a sermon. Not necessarily any of that. It is you. And when I say you, I'm talking about me too. It's me. It's you. This is how we begin to turn the world upside down. Now, I want you to go with me to 1 Thessalonians. Remember, chapter 17 was the account of where the church there at Thessalonica began. Paul went there, opened a ledge, explained, persuaded, and people got saved. He was there for 3 weeks. Got run out of town. I mean, there were some problems. There was a riot. We had some bad dudes after him. But the gospel went forward, and the gospel exploded, and there was a church there, and they did really, really great. So if you look with me at 1 Thessalonians, and if you look here, I want you to see chapter 1. I want you to see verse 5. So this is Paul writing back, and chapters 1 and 2 of 1 Thessalonians are kind of telling a little bit of the story, what happened in chapter 17 of Acts. So he's writing back to them and reminding them about the beginning of the gospel for them. And notice what he says in verse number 5. For our gospel came not unto you in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Ghost and in much assurance, as ye know what manner of men we were among you for your sake. Now I want you to notice that turning the world upside down, it starts with you. Notice that Paul was telling them, you knew us. You knew our testimony. You knew what manner of man we were. Now, this is a hard rub here because sometimes you've listened to the world. You've listened to the lust of the flesh. You've listened to the lust of the eyes. And you've listened to the pride of life. And you said, I can live my life how I want to live my life. And I can be a Christian and I can honor God. No, you cannot. God is calling you to a greater place. God is calling you to holiness. God is calling you to a life of righteousness. And guess what? Paul, wherever he went, he had a manner of way or a manner of life that he lived. And guess what? These Thessalonians, guess what? They saw that, and Paul says, we came to you, and you saw us. You saw the life that we led. Sadly, one of the reasons why you're failing in impacting anyone else's life is simply because your life is not a very good testimony. Maybe you got a bad habit. Maybe you got a hang up. Maybe you got some type of addiction. Maybe you got some type of, you've given into the flesh too often in your life. You need to go on a diet. You know what I'm saying? Maybe you're going down this path and you just given into the pride of life that I'm okay. I'm okay. I'm just fine. I want to encourage you that we need to have a good testimony if we're going to do anything for Christ. You say, but Pastor, I'm not perfect. Yeah, me neither. We're not talking about these kind of things. We're talking about this desire to live a holy life and a life that's honoring to the Lord. I mean, we've got to come to the place to where we say, hey, you know what? You knew what we were all about, and it was because we wanted to see you. Because they received the word. Notice what it takes also right here in 1 Thessalonians. Look at chapter 2. Look at verse 2. But after that we had suffered before and were shamefully entreated, as you know, at Philippi. So he's recounting what happened to Philippi before he got to Thessalonica. We were bold in our God to speak unto you the gospel of God, which much contention. And so you want to turn the world upside down, you got to live a good life. You got to live a holy life. You got to give it. You got to give those fleshly things in your life. You got to give them captive to the Lord. Ask God to help you with those things so that you can go and preach the gospel with boldness. The reason why we don't have boldness is because we're not living the life of the beginning. We can live without fear. We got to live a life that's honoring to God. Notice here, it takes a little bit of boldness. You want to make a difference? You want to turn the world upside down? It takes some boldness. Right there in verse 2, it says, we were bold in our God to speak to you. Notice the boldness wasn't in a fleshly, hey, look how good I can speak. No, it was boldness in our God. It's about who God is. Later in this passage, you see, they didn't come with slick words or anything like that. Look at verse 3. It says, for our exhortation, to chapter 2 of 1 Thessalonians, for our exhortation was not of deceit, nor of uncleanness, nor in guile. So it was very honest about it. It's very honest. I mean, I'm sure you've been with people in life. You've had interactions with people. And they're just not an honest person. You can't trust them. If their mouth is moving, they're lying, right? You know what I'm talking about. They're just not trustworthy in that way. But you really want to turn the world upside down in our culture? Our culture, that is accepted. To lie is accepted. To lie and to cheat and to steal is standard. You want to do something different in this world? You want to turn it upside down? You want to get it right to where it needs to be, if you will? What you got to do is you got to say, hey, I got to be bold. I got to be honest. I got to be a God pleaser more than a man pleaser. Look at verse 4. Chapter 2, verse 4. But as we were allowed of God to be put in trust with the gospel, even so we speak, not as pleasing men, but God. We tryeth our hearts. There's a good old phrase, they speak through a forked tongue. Kind of like it's an allusion to what Satan and the conversation Eve had with Satan, you know. He says, God has not said this, you shall not surely die. Well, guess what? She's dead. And it may not happen right at that moment, but you know what? She died. And by one man's sin, death passed upon all men. And so guess what? We are in a predicament. We're living in a world that thinks it's upside, that it's in the right way, but it's contrary to the things of God. I'm wondering, are there areas in your life that you have just given in? Let me encourage you, be a God pleaser rather than a man pleaser. Do what God wants you to do rather than the pressures of this world. There's always going to be pressures. And you say, hey, I really want to do something. I really want to make a difference. I really want to turn the world upside down. I want to see Jesus magnified. I want to see people get saved. You got to be bold a little bit. It's going to take some boldness. You're going to have to make sure that people know that, hey, I want to be a God pleaser. And that the power comes from the Holy Spirit. Notice verse 5. For neither at any time using we flattering words, as you know, nor a cloak of covetousness. God is witness. He says, we were led by the Spirit of God. Amen. This is what we did. We spoke the words of God to you. It wasn't out of deceit or a cloak or slick words. We told you. And this is why we have to sometimes from the pulpit, we have to speak very plainly about things. Yes. We need to call sin, sin. And we need to call out our own sin, and we need to do all of that. But we can't get into this slick kind of speech. We got to be bold about our God. We need to be bold about the Scriptures. We need to be bold about what we want in life. And we want to see people get saved. We want to follow Paul's pattern. We want to do that. But it also takes some preparation. Nobody likes the work, right? Sometimes I'm very skilled at certain things. I was a home builder for many years, a handyman for a long. And you know, my worst part of doing a project is getting ready for the project. That's tedious. And then cleaning up the project. Thank the Lord for my wife. She cleans up after me. Amen? I know it's rough. Yeah, it's tough. But those are the tedious things. But we have to know that when we want to turn the world upside down, it's going to take some preparation. We got to say, hey, we got to get into this. Notice in chapter 17 of the book of Acts, we were there earlier. Notice what it says in verse 2. And Paul, as his manner was, went in unto them. He reasoned with them out of the Scriptures, opening, alleging that Christ must needs have suffered. And so, guess what? It took some dialogue. It took some preparation to see people get saved. He had to talk with them and show him his testimony. You have to have some prep. You have to have a singleness of heart. And say, hey, I'm going to make this work. So sometimes you've been praying for that person. Guess what? Keep praying. Keep planting them seeds. You know, seeds are so important to plant. I mean, we've really got quite a few wildflowers this year. How many still have some, huh? Got some wildflowers in your yard. They're weeds. I'm calling them weeds. But the gospel seed is so very important. You say, well, they didn't hear me. We need to open and allege, and we need to share, because these are the seeds that keep on going forward, and it's the prep work. It's the hoeing. It's the tilling. It's getting the ground ready. Notice what Paul said about his mindset. Look at 1 Corinthians. So if we're in Acts, just go to Romans and then the next book, 1 Corinthians chapter 2. And look at verse 2. He says, for I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and him crucified. So Paul says, listen, I don't want to hear all about that. I've determined, man, I'm going to be about Jesus Christ and Him crucified. I'm going to be bold about that. I'm going to be prepped about that. That's what I'm going to be talking about. That's what I'm going to be going forward. Go back to Acts 17 quickly here. Not only do you need to have some prep in your life and be determined, if you will, you got to be a caring person. Not everyone is naturally gifted with caring. Some are not very caring. Have you met them? Yes, you've met them. Many of you, your mother was very caring. You get that. Some, maybe not some, but most mothers are. But you want to do something, you've got to be invested in other people and care about other people. In Acts chapter 17, you'll notice that in verse 4, the Bible says that some of them believed. So for 3 weeks, Paul opened and alleged and explained the scriptures and persuaded them towards Christ. And then it says some of them believed. Notice it says, and then consorted with. That just means that they got together, they fellowshiped together, they cared for one another. So Paul just didn't give them the sermon. He wasn't just the pastor and the sermon is over. He was the shepherd. And he was encouraging them and giving fellowship with them and consorting with them and being with them and teaching them and discipling them and sharing with them the truth of the scriptures. And so, hey, one of the things that we have to know is we have to care for other people. You know, one of the reasons why we don't win more, one of the reasons why we don't soul win more, one of the reasons why we're not seeing people change in our life is because we don't love them enough. We don't care enough. Man, oftentimes I'm pretty busy. I get some things in my mind and I just go about my business. And sometimes people are all over the place. I don't even notice them. Boy, I'm so convicted at times about that. But I think if we want to make a difference and turn the world upside down, we got to add a little care to our life. We got to love people. Look at what it says over there in 1 Thessalonians chapter number 2. Look at Paul and how he treated the church here in verse 7. He says, but we were gentle among you, even as a nurse cherished her children. So being affectionately desirous of you, we were willing to have imparted unto you not the gospel of God only, but also our own souls, because ye were dear unto us. Do you think Paul loved those people? I don't know about you, people that love me, and when they share things with me, it means so much more. Anybody could be a critic. Did you know that? And I've had critics over the years. Yes, I know, it's hard to believe, but you know. There's always critics. By the way, if you ever do anything for the cause of Christ, there will be some critics in your life. You ever advance the gospel? You ever strive for holiness? Guess what? There's going to be a critic. There will. Just be ready for that. But the people that love me and have shown, like Paul did to these people, affectionate and giving of their own souls. And guess what? When they share, it means something very, very much to me. And I really think it'll impact others. And when you start really loving people, that is how you can make a huge difference. You got to add some care into your life. You say, how do I do that? You know what? Here, I think each one of us has the capacity to do a little bit better at caring. How many would agree? Hey, I think you're right on that one, Pastor. I think we all could do a little bit better on caring. Now, Pastor, you say, how come we're not caring more? Well, it could be a lot of different reasons. It could be the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life, the things that are in the world. It could be. It could be that you can't handle any more because you've already filled your life with all sorts of things. There is no room for any other thing. And so maybe that classifies itself as maybe not a sin, but a weight that does so easily beset you. Maybe you're not loving people because, you know what, you've got all sorts of things going on, and you know what, your life has been so packed out with the things of this world that you fail to love people like Paul did. Paul was flying by the seat of his pants. Not that he didn't have a plan, because everywhere he did, he had a plan, didn't he? He had a pattern. It was all about Jesus. But you know what? He got run out of town. You know what he did? He just kept on preaching. He just kept on loving. Kept on showing himself to others so that the gospel of Christ could go forward. I'm wondering if we need to reevaluate how we live our life a little bit. You say, well, I'm busy on Sunday. I can't go to church. You know, you're here. You're here on Sunday. I guess I'm speaking to the choir here tonight. But there's some that are not here. I don't know why they're not here. Why are they not here? Well, they got busy. They got things to do, whatever it might be. Listen, I submit to you. Maybe you need to recognize that you have a church family that loves you and cares for you and needs you. And if you love them enough, you'll care enough about them to get your hiney in church. There you go. But no, because it's about me, right? No, it's not about you. It's about caring others. Look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 2 quickly here. Verse number 9. For ye remember, brethren, our labor and travail, for laboring night and day, because we would not be chargeable unto any of you. We preach unto you the gospel of God. What was happening here? Paul says, hey, you know what we did? We went to the market and we made tents and we sold tents and we didn't take any money from you, because we wanted you to receive the gospel. And we didn't want you to think it was because you gave us something. And so I submit to you, take some sacrifice to turn the world upside down. You know, sadly, we're not willing to sacrifice anymore. It's too hard. I like my creature comforts. I get it. I don't want to sacrifice either about some things. But when we're thinking about the cause of Christ here, maybe our time, maybe our resources, hey, it's time for us to say, hey, I'm willing to sacrifice for the cause of Christ. I'm willing to be a part of turning the world upside down. Take some sacrifice. Quickly here, look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, look at verse 5. The last part he says, as ye know what manner of men we were among you for your sake. Now go to chapter 2, look at verse 10 on that. Chapter 2, verse 10, he says, ye are our witnesses, and God also, how holy and justly and unblamely we behaved ourselves among you that believe. You know what this tells me? Paul was making a point to the church. It says, hey, when we came, you remember how, what manner of man we were? You remember how we kind of showed you ourselves and how we didn't take from you? We weren't just trying to say things so that we can get something from you. And you remember how honestly we were with you? You believed that we were just honest and all of that. It speaks to the word real. You see, you want to turn the world upside down and you want to make an impact for the cause of Christ, you have to be real. You have to be who you are. And sadly, Christian, some people are a Christian on Sunday, and we can't find them on Monday. They're MIA, missing in action. It's because they're not necessarily real. Verse 10, witnesses of God, holy and justly, unblamably, they behave themselves. We're not that. And so you got to have somebody who is real. Strive to be honest. Strive to be real. I like the people that come up to me and they say, you know, I'm just going to be honest with you, preacher. I'm like, okay, here goes. I'm like, do I want to really hear this? Okay. I'm just going to be honest with you. This is how I am. And they tell me, I say, okay, can I be honest with you now? I'm like, why don't you stop that? You just told me how honest you are and all these things that you're doing, and that you're okay with that. Well, let me show you from the scripture, share them these things. How about you? Are you ready to be real and to be honoring to God and holy to God? And are you ready to be that witness that God wants you to be? And we'll be real about that. So it's not some great thing because you could say, hey, I'm just real. I just be honest. Did you know God knows you anyways? God knows you anyways. I don't know you. I swear, a couple people said, Pastor, it's like you're hanging out with me at home, all these sermons that you preach, they're just hitting me. I'm like, no, I wasn't there. One lady said, Pastor, I'm mad because you mentioned me in your sermon. I said, I guarantee you it wasn't about you. I wasn't even thinking about you. But we just have to make sure that we are real and authentic. Paul was. And then I'll just leave you at this. Chapter 17 and Paul, the riot comes. The lowlifes come out. The cause is seen. And they get run out of town. And guess what? If you want to turn the world upside down, you got to have a little tenacity. This means that you got a little no quit in you. And Paul had no quit in him. He got run out of Thessalonica. You know where he went? He went to Berea. What did he do? He went to the synagogue. He opened an alleged. He did the very same thing. In fact, he says, you know what? And they actually received the word a little bit better than you guys did. That's what they said. And so, you know what? I think sometimes we quit too early. It's like we do counseling and marriage counseling at time to time. And they say, you know, Pastor, what do I need to do? And I say, okay, here's some homework. You know, I want you to practice this with your wife or practice this with your husband and whatever. And they come back a couple days. It didn't work. I tried it once. We got to have a little tenacity here, don't we? Don't give in. Remember what Paul did? He opened an alleged. He took the word of God. He persuaded them. Let's have a little tenacity. Let's have a little no quit. Let's not quit. Let's not give in. Let's not give place to the devil. Let's go forward. And let's have an opportunity where we could say, you know what? We behaved ourselves. You know what manner of men we were. And you know what? Guess what? There will be some that believe and there will be some that don't. And I think you'll be able to discern in a proper way. If you've done everything that you're supposed to do, you live your whole life, then you're just okay with that because you've done everything you can do. Right. And you're okay with whatever the results are because those are God's. God determines those kinds of things. But let's not go around naively thinking we can live how we want and give into the lust of the flesh, the pride of life and all of that and say, you know what? Yeah, I want to do something great for God. I want to see the world upside down. No, it's time for you to get right today. Commit to the gospel again. Say, I'm going to go out there and I'm going to be part of the gospel ministry. I'm going to open. I'm going to ledge. I'm going to dialogue. And I'm going to persuade people to come to know the Lord Jesus because he died for me. He was buried and rose again victoriously the third day. If you're saved today, this ought to encourage you to go out there and be a light for the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Maybe you're here and you've never been saved. You don't know for sure that if you die today, you go to heaven. You don't know that. Let me encourage you. The gospel is simple. All have sinned. That's me. That's you. The Bible says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Anybody can be saved. It's simple. I'd encourage you, if you need to know how to be saved, I'd love to show you from the Bible how you could be saved. Christian, we talked about these qualities that were needed. Let the Spirit lead you in this way. Maybe you're lacking a little real authenticness. Maybe it's time for you just to leave something in the past. Maybe it's time for you just to say, you know what, Lord, I'm going to give this habit to you. I'm going to let it go. I'm going to trust you so that I can be a part of turning the world upside down. Let's pray together. Lord, we love you today. We're mindful of the message today. And we just ask that you do your work. Lord, we know your spirit is powerful. We know that it works. And Lord, the word went forward today. We saw Paul's pattern. We saw what happened. People got saved. We saw why. Because he was bold. He was real. He sacrificed. He was loving and caring. And Lord, I pray that all of those things would be a part of our lives so that we could turn the world upside down and have a testimony like that. Lord, we love you and we pray that you bless this invitation, Lord. In your way we pray. Amen. Let's just kind of stand together if you can. With our heads bowed, our eyes closed. The instrument's going to go ahead and start playing. And this is the time that you can do business with the Lord. As the Lord talked to you today, this altar is available for you. Has the Lord spoken to you? Has he convicted you? Maybe you're here and you need to be saved. Let me come on up. I'd love to show you from the Bible. Have someone take a little time and tender, lovingly care to show you from the Scripture how to be saved. Maybe there's an area in your personal testimony that the Lord just kind of pricked at your heart. Why don't you just submit that to the Lord today? Let the Lord captivate it. Let the Lord seal that. Let the Lord put that in the past as only the Lord can. One more stanza, then we'll be done. Just wanted to give us opportunity. Don't let this slip out. It's precious when the Lord speaks to us about something. It means that he loves you, that he cares about you, and wants you to walk in his way, because that is the path of peace. That is the path of happiness. All right, let's close in a word of prayer. Lord Jesus, we thank you for once again this opportunity to be with one another. I pray, Lord, that the word that went out will continue to simmer in our hearts and our lives, and help us to be like Paul here and his pattern, and seeing people saved and through his love and his care and his boldness. Help us to apply these areas to our lives so that we as a church and we as individuals can turn this world upside down. Lord, dismiss us with your blessings. We pray this in your name. Amen. God bless you, folks. You are dismissed.